if for the benefit of time, I just want you not to talk more. I'll just open a very web trawling thing in nowadays, what is testing? And I get up to this video. How many have watched it? Loved it?
Testing అంటే ఏంటో తెలుసా యూజింగ్ ద అప్లికేషన్ విత్ ఎ గుడ్ పేషెంట్ ఇన్ ఆల్ ద పాసిబిలిటీస్ విత్ డిఫరెంట్ డిఫరెంట్ టైప్
ఇన్ ఆర్డర్ టు కన్ఫర్మ్ whether the application is working according to the requirements or not and also user friendly or not, that is known as testing. Okay, testing means using a come on here. Yes, using with one idea na with a different possible idea. In all the possible ways we will use the application. Are you getting my point? With all the maximum ideas whatever we get to, we may miss one or two ideas also, we are human beings, no? But maximum possible, what is that? So maximum possible ideas we will be implementing and we will be testing it. Is it clear, Nana? So testing is any technology? Is it like some Java, .NET program? Or it's not. Chapanma, a technology. Then what is it? It is one process. It is one. Come on, friends. So testing is a process in which we will first use the application and we'll try to identify the defects in it. Defects means if anything is not working according to the customer requirement, that is known as a defect. I already told you. So defect means deviation from the customer's requirement. So whenever we are using, if it is
all right, I'm hoping we all are not doing testing like this. All right, probably I can start early. That's fine. All right, so hi all. More voices, come on. Yes, cool. So I was just wondering if you guys are checking your mobiles and checking Google traffic to your home or weather forecast. Is it? Are you thinking of skipping this talk? Yes or no? No? Oh, please be honest, because I was thinking. All right, so I just hope in this, the biggest problem in this world, I feel like traffic is the most problem, and I feel that there should be some scale up and scale down, like AWS mechanism of roads, and you just can zoom and reach your home. Fine, anyways, so let me come back to the talk which I'm going to talk about today is, hi, by the way, I didn't introduce myself. I'm Pooja from Team Moengage. Let me give a brief detail what our product, what it does. We're into a customer re-engaging marketing platform wherein we provide a product to our customers which they can use to re-engage their customers. So in simple words, we do provide a solution which actually generates notifications on your utility products like Snapdeal, BigBasket, Swiggy, or ClearTrip, wherein you or your wife or your girlfriend gets addicted to shopping more and exceeding your monthly credit card bills. All right, so don't curse me for that. But this is how our business works. So we help our customers get richer, and so we do become rich more. This is like very favorite thing. All right, so coming back to the topic which I'm going to talk about. So initially in my talk, in abstraction, I said about, okay, I'll be talking about my journey, but I'm changing it slightly a bit. I'm not going to talk about me alone. So I'm going to talk about you, or maybe from all of you. I'm going to bring your inner voices out while trying the scalable solution, the trying test automation framework from the scratch, or finding the dead end when you try to scale to the next product needs, or scratching your head how to solve them. All the pains, all the roller coaster rides you might have had earlier or maybe going to have. So I'm going to talk few hottest of them, and then telling you what kind of workarounds work for us while working, specifically working for products like e-commerce ones, my earlier workplace, GoIBO, and the current workplace. So we kind of have similar problems, but different with different sets. So having said that, how many of you relate while with me while writing automation, test automation from the scratch and scaling is a painful task? Raise your hand. Very few. Others, geniuses. All right, so why do you feel so it is a painful task? Any answer? Come on, I used to think only I'm the one who is shy. No? Okay, let me tell you. So what makes you feel that is same thing which works today, which you made it work today, may not work tomorrow. It's you call flakiness, and that is why you feel that it's not, it's taking too much time of me to automate, and I'm not able to consider my quality of my product. I'm just focusing complete time on scaling my product. My product means the automation framework, right? And that's where you scratch your head and think that, oh man, who was that man who said that one day that automation will free me forever and I will go to Himalayas after that? That man was Simon. All right, he created Selenium and made this, okay, Selenium will make our life easy and get you time to, once you automate and use every time. But there are roller coaster rides which everybody, I'm sure, would have had or will have. So I'm going to talk a few of them. Right. So starting with the ideal world situation. So we kind of heard in agile, being agile, you always focus on your unit tests, more than API tests, integration tests basically, and then you move on to your GUI test, and then you think about, okay, at last do manual test of the wherever the more human intelligence is required. So I want to see the hands up for those who strictly follow this. Few, four, five, six. Okay, keep your hands up. Keep your hands raised. Okay, now put your hands down if you do it, if you're not doing it for your mobile apps also. Okay, so assume, I'm not sure, so you have, in general nowadays, each product has mobile and the web form also. So hardly we have two people, clap for them, who are doing it same thing for mobile also and web also. They deserve clap, seriously. So what about others? Why we are not able to approach it? Even if we want to do it, why we're not able to approach it? Any guesses? Okay, so what he says is, your mobile apps can have hybrid and native nature plus the responsive web nature also, so wherein your time gets consumed in automating all these flavors, and then again checking on different devices. So something like this generally happens in real world for mobile app testing, and you end up doing endless iteration and figuring out when I'll be able to actually publish my app to the app store. Sort of. So the people who did not raise hand, I'm thinking they all are doing this fashion still. Is it? Yes? Okay. You don't have any second opinion now because you didn't raise hands. All right. So this was a common problem for us also when we started thinking of automating everything. And we kind of keep doing this. And at the same time, we had time problem. Okay. We don't have time. When do we automate? So the very classic example of axe, if you don't sharpen your axe and you always feel that you don't have time to do it, at last you will end up doing the death trap of keep doing this again and again. So it's where we thought, okay, we'll not only depend on manual testing because of these common problems which everybody knows now, varieties of desktop web browsers, varieties of mWeb browser types in their make and model of different mobile handsets. And then you have apps, Android, iOS, they behave differently, and the developers of those teams are also different. They have different designs. So a lot of things to take care of, and that too, we need to know which tool will reliably do the rest, not making it flaky, wherein you again spend time. So these are the common problems. And the very, very important one, the last minute changes. So who among us don't hate developers giving last moment changes and feeling like killing them that moment? Being in e-commerce, one very big lesson I learned is last minute changes are inevitable to come. No matter whatever processes you set, no matter how many hygiene processes you try to bring in, they are prone to come because this is a high-paced environment, this is a business-driven environment, and you cannot just stop them coming in. So what should you do? You should have a safety net. So my friend Anand always says that automation is a safety net. So you should put the safety net around it. One of them is whatever your product is. So it's where we also started thinking of, okay, last minute changes looks like, okay, if we have unit test and integration test, at least we can control it. So next layer, we tried doing it. We had integration tests in place, wherein we found it, yes, we were finding some bugs. But then over the period of time, we started figuring out these were not sufficient because we kind of ending finding this way. So assume that my app, which is placed in App Store from a month now, and all of a sudden it breaks. There is no release from the app side, but backend release has been made. It broke the app side also. What could be the reason? So these are the few biggest reasons we found is the API parameters which were passed to from the backend to the app side were changed, and other one, the HTML templates being passed. The encoding type of them was changed. So you might have seen in apps, with iOS app specifically, it takes a complete month of cycle to get your app published there. So you always feel that some control, which we dynamically want to render, we will push from the backend. So that is what we got into trouble in. Now you might have a question, if we already had unit testing, integration testing in place, why would this first problem would happen? API parameters get changed. Anybody encountered this? Any reason behind it? You had your API test, you had your integration test in place. Why it didn't catch that? Who said yes? They have to answer. Okay, so let me tell you in my experience what used to happen is the person who had written or changed the backend API is the same person who had written the test. So his expected result, his actual result was according to him or her. Getting my point? So one check here we could put is we could again put the review cycle of the test or whoever developed the test. But having said that last minute change, which I was talking earlier, last minute changes do not give you privilege to do that. So that is where you need to have safety net again. And the second point, HTML changes also. The same problem, the encoding changes and your app starts rendering wrong HTML or HTML content itself. You might have observed in some apps, ampersand NBSP, ampersand AMP slashes, etc. So why it could be happening? It was not happening when you released it. And you just bang your hand, why it's happening? It's because of some of the backend release, we pushed the data in wrong format or wrong encoding. So these are the common problems we also had. And then we thought, this is a high time. We need safety nets for web as completely and mobile as much as possible. So that's where we thought we shall not pass in any way, whatever comes in. So for web, Selenium was the obvious choice. I always love Selenium. And for mobile app, there were quite a few choices when we started thinking of using them. Calabash was one among the one which was very stable in that nature. But for our product need, we always wanted our existing framework to scale. So we already had a framework which used to do web automation, get the logs, publish reports, publish screenshots, everything in place by this time. And we wanted to scale the same. We do not want to have a separate framework altogether. And second thing, for sure, we did not want to change the AUT, the application under test. So that is where it made us choose APM. So whenever you guys choose your own tool, think across according to your existing framework you are having, according to your existing resources. If people are good with Ruby or Cucumber kind of style, go for Calabash then. So you should choose accordingly. So this is how we ended up choosing APM. But having said that, how many of you are using APM? Okay, cool. How many of you, raise your hands. How many of you used to use it before 2 years when it started? One or two? Yeah? So remember errors like simulator crashed at boot up? APM crashed at boot up? And if it opens, it again crashes? Or if it is successfully running in front of you and you go to your manager or CTO and show, look, I made it working and it breaks again in front of him. Yeah? Happened? Yes. So similar things, it happened to us also. And that's where I learned a very fundamental basics about how to work with open source tool. So I'm not going to take left. Okay, so we also had similar bigger problems like this. I'm not noting all of them. If you want to know all of them, just go to APM/APM issues filter by Pooja. You will get to know all of them. So I kind of started making them, the APM community, the great APM community, piss off with all my queries, all my questions. There, so you can find there. But then the evolution happened. The evolution happened in a way, the same problem which I was facing somehow in the struggle with my trials, with the community, great people, great supportive people, they came up with some workaround which used to work for my product. And similarly, other people used to ask the question. So that way, it was a help engine. So that's why I said that be part of this journey. So I kind of having solutions for multiple problems which I was keep getting in. So one of them was APM server inspector crash or stuck. So this is not specific, let's not make it specific to APM. It can be any tool which you try. And when you start doing it, you are the one who starts it first, kind of, these things are keep on happening. So how do you tackle, I want any one example from anyone, how to tackle some such situation? Or what is the debugging way approach you do? Like Orange said that, it's like debugging person. So I also feel the same. Any example? Okay. Yeah. So same thing. When we want to know what is going wrong, we need logs, right? So take care. So one mantra. First mantra: figure out where the utility which you are using, where it stores the log. First thing. Second thing: where are you storing your log? So do have a logging mechanism. Avoid print statements. Do have a logging mechanism with proper log levels, debug, error, so that you can figure out your issues quickly. So this is the first mantra we learned that moment, and we figured out. Okay, now next. It crashes, okay. It crashes no matter what. What do you do next? You got to know the reason. Reasons are severals. So what do you do next? So that is where a very important lesson which could be utilized in across your projects is know your processes. The last point, I didn't write in this page maybe. Know your processes. So there can be several reasons behind your main setup to be crashing. Is maybe the other process which is interpreting or killing the process, actual process, figure out that from log. If you figure out that, find out the hook around how to restart back or how to kill the other process which is about to kill your process. So that is two things, very important aspects of working around such tools which which works in the virtual environment kind of stuff. Then choose the right locating strategy. Orion has talked about a good strategy today, and I'm not going to give more detail on it, but from the mobile context, I'll give you what works for specifically for APM this one. So you get to know that one locator, let's say XPath, you're trying for your web project, it works fantastically. You're trying for your mobile, it also has the same, let's say, same locator strategy, and it doesn't work. Then you realize, okay, put the lock, why it's not working, it throws null pointer, it throws stale, what kind of error it throws, based on that you again make a decision, right? But still, if your element is found, the worst case, your element is found, still it is not clickable. What could be the reason? Possible, okay, cool. So we got 2 points. One is it's not either visible or it's not the same page. Also, it can be a third problem with when you especially, Yes, web view also is one thing. Another thing, I didn't get? Overlapped, yeah, good point. I was about to come on this last point. Overlapping will come back, but the main reason with, specifically if you talk about iOS with XPath, the page source finds the item easily, but the UI automation which you interact with, you use any tool, it internally finally talks to UI automation to simulate the actions on iOS device or simulator, anything, which it has to know the same parsing level also, and which is not good handled in for XPath in iOS. So that is where you figure out, okay, this is not the right thing, just search. A simple search will give you good examples, like friend Matthew Popple knows his Bootstrap, he has written a very good things on this before me trying and juggling around it. So he has written for Ruby basically, so which shows that okay, for iOS specifically XPath, do not choose other strategies, choose what UI automation supports, one thing. Second thing is also know that, okay, the version compatibility thing, right? Some things may not work in your particular version of the tool which you are trying, and the issue is none already, and it is being solved in the next version. So try thinking of upgrading that. So that is also one thing you can do here. Third problem, okay, so here is a bug in this third is missing. So time consuming to test the test. How many of you relate with it when you tried actually mobile automation specifically? Only one? No, others did not do or still shy to raise hands? Okay, so why did you feel so? Yes, so thanks. So what he means is when you try mobile automation, it has to talk via proxy and then reach to your simulator or your device. So there are too many connections in between. So which takes time for server to boot up first, and then your simulator to boot up first, and then your test reaches there, and that is true. That is also a little slow. In case of Android, it's fine. In case of iOS, it is slow. It reaches that point, and then you go step by step to reach your, let's say you have 4 pages in your application, 4th page, you're trying one locator to test. 4 transitions, it will take time, right? So my approach, any approach you took to reduce this time taken? No? So what simple approach came in my mind is put the debug, skip the manual steps in between, all. Do it manually quickly, reach that last location, and then try your locator. Here a problem used to happen is, which initially, I'm not sure if it still happens, is the inspector gets flaky when you reach the last location and you want to ensure that your locator is actually gonna work fine. So you open the inspector, it doesn't work. It doesn't get you the tree XML. So what next solution we did is, when we know that this is what is not working and I want to try, I'll put my one more statement before, get the tree XML. So even if it fails there, I have my XML, I can parse it in XML viewer somewhere, XPath checker, and I can check that. Or if it is other identifiers, I can check them easily. So it started saving our time. So initially, I also had to feel, I used to feel that. I remember one day my manager comes and says that it becomes very time consuming and we are a business running company, we cannot afford this much of R&D time. Let's move to some other good tool which provides on the fly solution, like Orion talked about test IM. So similarly, we also had took demo from them, and I was like, I'm into this product, and I'm constantly talking to Dan and Emerge and everyone, and I'm figuring out that this solution, these problems are still going to take time to solve because everything is not in hand of APM. It has to do with UI automation also. So there are many things, many layers to it. I'm just wondering how they are able to solve it. So I just created my list. This list is just 5 points. That list was very big, and I'm sure they would have hated me afterwards. So I kind of wanted to do a more on the gestures part, where gestures were not very good supported by the tool because it is little slight difficult, specifically e-commerce project. Let's say you talk about search page. Search page has thousands of data or maybe billions of data to be populated, and it's where your APM server gets choked while parsing when you try to swipe down or swipe up, and you feel that I don't know how to solve this because it is busy in parsing those logs. It is busy in keep tracking of tree XML to find your locator, right? So similar problem happened to us. So I wanted this solution to happen to see if they are doing it magically. So of course the answer was no, and they would have hated me, but being polite and good people, they just said that, okay, our iOS devices are busy with other clients, let's still talk next month. So by the time I realized one fact that either this is not doable, or we should hold this project for some days and work on other QA practices around to solve this problem now and come back when it gets stable. And I was little, I did not know, be happy or being demoralized, but I was actually demoralized to see that. And then one single thing which made me change my complete thought process, I talked to my CTO and say that either we chuck this automation time because it's just time consuming for me, or we just give to third party, let them do everything. So I was like that. So then my CTO says one single line which made my complete change my complete perspective of thinking and working around such tools, is that he said that, okay, let's chuck it off, this problem, into sets. Let's target 10% solution every month. You're talking about 6 months it will take to be stabilized, the APM tool. 6 months you also take. And by the time we reach that journey, we both are in the right phase to have completely automated system. So this is what his line was, which made me put in my mind, which made me think one very good thing indirectly, is I just told myself, if nobody does, or if the moment I feel if nobody does or nobody can, I should be the one who can. So that is what changed my perspective. I started loving its pain point. I started being the part of journey, not necessarily by fixing bugs, but starting polling on who are asking the same questions or something. And then I realized, okay, by doing that, I got to know, I digged into APM's repository and figured out simulating gestures was possible if I would have taken the native approach. Any idea what could be that native approach? The question I will be asking, you will be knowing the answer probably. While using Selenium or WebDriver, if something doesn't work, even if you know that locator is fine, something doesn't work with WebDriver, what do you do? Yes. So that came to my mind. If there is JavaScript for WebDriver, there should be something similar for the mobile also. And that is where, with the help of dev teams, figured out, okay, for Android, ADB is the one. Awesome. For iOS, UI automation we already knew, but the commands and all were not in field. And then that's where we thought, okay, if we somehow able to inject this in our code with precise calculation from where to where I want to swipe off, precise calculation, my problem is solved. Who cares if I'm not doing it product to product to another product? If I'm knowing this is my size of simulator, and within this size I'm going to test my test, I want to, it means I want to scroll 10 products down And I have calculated it mathematically. For reaching 10th element, this is what is required. Push the ADP command. Push the UI automation command. Or UI automation, one good thing happens is you can use the name strategy. So if you know your search results priorly, in that case, you can use it. But in our case, it was not the helpful thing because dynamic project injection was there. So we cannot based on the other product, but we use similar strategy to find out other name. Let's take a typical example of app of like a Swiggy, and you have food items. So let's say first item is paneer, and the last item is dal makhani, and you want to reach from paneer to dal makhani. So one way is either you know 100% the 10th item is dal makhani, then you can relate on it. But it is not the true case. Dal makhani is gone, let's say. There is something else. You cannot depend on that. So what do you do then? So you could also utilize other name strategy also. Dal makhani is fine, but there might be other properties to it which are going to be specific that you have to find out from your product understanding, which I or nobody can tell. So that is where many problems you don't find solutions directly on internet, and that is where you find that that is where the second diagram we end up doing manual. So how you can do it, this is how my story is, our story is, and we also started with that. And by this time, we kind of had enough automated tests. Okay, one point I'm missing here is this. Yeah, so coming back to your point, overlapping. Somebody said overlapping, right? So one component, the locating strategy. You feel that your component is found, but still it is not clickable. We kind of had this problem big time. And I was just wondering, same thing if I do manually, or same thing if I run in debug, it works fantastically fine. But what if I execute it in a parameterization test, data-driven testing? For second test, it fails. Third test again works. Fourth test also it works. Fifth test again fails. So it was like random nature. So I was not able to figure out what would be going wrong. This is where watching your tree helped me. So watching the tree shown me exactly. I was, so there was a pop-up basically, give me a little background. There was a pop-up on the screen, home screen, which says yes or no button. So you have to click on either yes or no. I wanted to click on no. I was expecting it should click on no, but it was never clicking it. Some tests it was, some tests it was not. By viewing the exact XML, I got to know there were overlapping two pop-ups, you see. So right now it is very neat to watch, otherwise it will be big tree XML where you cannot find it. So how it happened is based on the hints I got by rerunning at least twice. So hints came, something looks like that. So the major hint we got from this is we should have specifically for overlapping contents like pop-ups, overview, overlays, for such components we should have different kind of handling. Just find element would not solve that. Why? Because find element finds the multiple elements, and the first one is given the priority, and you apply click, which is not visible. So it is gonna fail, correct? Right, so that is where we kind of had another utility function wrapped around find with visibility. If whichever is visible, click, otherwise iterate through all the elements found. So this was one big trick work, and trust me, now when I say giving you problem and solution, it looks very easy, but when you get into trouble, you don't know what is going wrong. So this is what happened, and after a lot of understanding, proper logging, proper screenshot, we got to know what was wrong. Okay, so coming to the last point, this is also one which you can directly not find by telling your problem to someone until you're into problem. So I will give you a typical case. So at GoIBibo, we had in iOS, we had a search flight option, auto suggest, which used to give you flights across the globe. So whenever I'm trying to do it manually, it works. But when I'm trying to automate, inspector crashes, first thing, I cannot identify a flight. Problem. Second thing is, Even if you somehow able to get via your pre-XML finding your locator and you try to put the same in running the code, it still doesn't work. So any idea people have got into such problems? No? No? Okay. Okay. Good. So I should clap for everyone then. Okay. So we got into such problem wherein it doesn't work. And by trying and realizing, seeing the APM logs, we got to know that APM has got stuck, too busy parsing all the flight details. It was trying to build those nodes for all the flights. So if there are millions of data in your SQLite DB, it is trying to pass that. It cannot do parallel execution until it finishes everything and then come back to give you the 3XML. So that was a huge problem for us. And that's where a simple, very simple trick helped. Just tell APM log to shut off. Say log level is equals to error. And that saved our life. But sometimes we wanted debug log also to see. So then took the developer's help. We knew what is the test data for us. So we knew that we are testing against, let's say, 50 data only. So we created a separate app with separate 50 items DB only. So that also worked. So but to know the solution, you need to get into the problem. So that's the idea, that's the concept. It's not about APM or any tool. It's about the same concept or same approach or same set of problems you will be getting whatever library you use. Second thing is duplicating thing we have already talked. So I'll just move on. Okay, so once we were done with all these activities, the main thing came to us was the transparency layer, creating transparency layer. Otherwise, what would happen? Night, 1 o'clock call. Hey, Pooja, I just want to run this test and give me the feedback fast. Second day also, it happens same. And if the test fails, they need to, again, on call only, they want to know. Why it failed? What is wrong? Tell me. And you just feel like, I have created automation. Oh man, I have did such a brainy job. Nobody is recognizing that. They are just thinking that I'm a feedback engine. All right, so it is very, very important for you to create the transparency layer so that anybody can access it. Access your logs, access your screenshots, access your test reports properly. So this was in our brain, and they are good tools, but the moment I used Jenkins, I started loving it, so I did not think about any other tool. So, everywhere it is a but. So, using any CI tool, I am assuming nowadays everybody is using it. Yeah? Jenkins? Yeah? Okay. So do you think once you set up your test there, it's always a calm water, lazy river you can row? Always? Or do you feel there is a tsunami is about to come? Or you feel tsunami has already come, I don't know what to do. The release is there, I need to fix it fast. Oh no, run on locally and tell the feedback first. Happened? Yes, so similar thing happened to us also, and we wanted to stabilize this. So we were seeing that flaky test on remote machine, because Jenkins we hosted on remote machine. If the same thing I work on local Jenkins, it works perfectly. So there were a few big reasons I would tell you. One of the biggest reasons when we took web test hosting, we figured out the main reason was the remote machine is a headless machine, and you were thinking that it is to automatically invoke the Firefox or Chrome or any other browser and do it. It cannot do because it's a headless machine. So that's where the awesome tool XVRB, who were created thanks to them. So awesome tool XVRB, a simple setting makes your life easy. It removes those errors. Window cannot be invoked. Or one more trick here, actually, it took me days to figure out this resolution setting. So there are, even if you have invoked your, you have set the XVRB and it streams, it actually does all the graphical actions without invoking Firefox and does everything and gives you a screenshot also. There are chances when you might have noticed element is not clickable at this point, and that too in Jenkins only. It works fantastically on your local. The reason is it invokes its own resolution. You need to try for your product, your window size. You have to try for your product and come up with the right resolution setting. So this is one which works for almost all products. This I tried and with trial and error. Another thing you can do control with your code also, the dimensions class, whichever language you use, you can control it with that also. So this requires a trial and error approach. So this is a life-saving trick though. Okay, so third thing I was talking about earlier, the know your processes. Okay, how to debug, we talked about logs, you should have logs, you should have screenshots. You should know the processes also. How many of you don't think that it is DevOps job? Why should I know about what is running in my system? Okay, people are smiling. Okay, so I would not embarrass more. Yes, we must know our processes. What processes are running so that we can know how to restart or which one to restart and what time to restart back. Example, let's take the classic example. Your simulator crashes up. So I have kept my simulator up. I don't know how to see now. Okay. So if it crashes, I need to know at very moment, or maybe in 30 seconds or 40 seconds, that it is crashed so that I can invoke it back. So whenever test is running, it does not hamper my actual testing and make it flaky test just because it was not invoked. How do you know? It's very simple way. Actually, if you look at this, it's a simple way. You just need to learn few Linux commands, ps, grep, aux, etc. to figure out what processes are running and find the pattern when your tests are not running basically. So for our case, it used to happen whenever just before release, we used to run all of them in parallel. That time, the randomness used to happen. So we found out that pattern and kept the logs even in the processes. What were the processes were spawning or killing others? So we figured out the fine balance to restart. If nothing works, reboot machine works, right? Same way. So you either find the culprit or you find the solution. So that's the two approaches. So I go for both, depend on the need. So there is one beautiful tool, Monit, to help you doing it easily. You just need to tell it which process to invoke. So you can write shell script to start or stop, and you can put it inside the Monit. It takes care of it automatically, when to start and when to stop. All right. So by this moment, we were done with many tests now for web, mobile, different flavors of mWeb and kind of native apps, hybrid apps. So we kind of had native come hybrid, but most of the times what our tests were about native testing. So here one more daunting need came is we wanted a single point of contact or single point where we could watch all of our test feedback easily. Why? The reason, if you have to take, let's say you are the release engineer, you have to take the call of go, no go. How would you take if you have to watch 50 tests altogether? It will take time. You will see green bulb or red bulb. You will be determining, okay, these are the failing, but you have to again go inside and see what is the release version which is it is failing on, right? So similar problems we also had here, and we really wanted some solution to solve this. And on top of that, one more problem, which is like, if by any chance, so this if happens oftenly. If by any chance your code after all the safety nets breaks on production, what do you do? So this is a simple clip to showcase that when you try to fix production bugs, right? So you think that, like, you as a team with developer think that we would be doing this, then it will be solving. One bug solved. Second bug. Oh man. Whew, solved. So similar pain points happened with us also, and we kind of solving one bug and introduce another bug in production. Bad practice, right? So that is where we also wanted to do something which can tell us, okay, what do we do if some bug comes in the production? One way is keep solving there. No, another way is revert back immediately because our production is customer centric. It's a consumer centric. A 1 second of mistake can lead their wrong transactions and can lead malign our image. Complete work is gone, right? So we wanted immediately revert back to the previous versions which were stable. So how do we know in one short span of time? Otherwise, there should be one person before release who gives no go. He needs 2 hours of time to watch all the tests, to vouch, to figure out the reasons, and then create a report in Excel or mail or somewhere and tell that this is why release should not go, right? And that too, we have a dependency on that person. So when we talk about automation, it's not about only test automation. It's about automating the complete process, which is what will make you someday go to Himalayas. Okay, so yeah, so this is what we wanted. I'm sorry. So I'll just skip the slides and I'll take you directly into the demo, what we did to solve that. So I have set up the local Jenkins, give you a little brief, and local Jenkins, and I have created test jobs around a particular application calculator, basic application. I took again credits to the people who developed it. So Android, iOS, and web applications I took from the open source community, and I kind of written the test around it. So you see 5 tests. So similarly, we had almost 50 tests in real time there. So seeing all of them, the big list, you have to scroll down and keep seeing and keep going inside and keep coming back to see what made it wrong was a difficult thing. So we came up with some simple solution like this. You see QuickView here, I have opened it here. Does it look better than that? It gives you complete clarity of all the jobs which you have run. It gives you the version number on which you had your code is run. It gives you the environment detail where it has run, so that it's not that you report some bug. It might have happened, right? You report some bug, and then developers comes back. This is a wrong bug. My code is not in that machine. You're not testing my code at all, right? So this information was very necessary for us, and we wanted to know the responsibles also, because of whose code it is broke. So this you can take care. Right now I have nominated myself because I was the only one on local Jenkins. Otherwise we can control this, how to feed the data inside it. So whoever's builds commits are there, that commit authors, we can pick it and put it here. So kind of, and it gives you direct links, detailed reports, screenshots, console, everything. So let's see, so green shows the past test, so both are passed. These are failed. So let me run you through how these are done. So the idea is to tell you can do similar for your work also. So I have created a simple deployment job. This is a mock job. This is not actually doing any deployment, but this can be a simple script to deploy the code on some particular machine. So let me see how to build it. So it takes 2 parameters. One is your test environment, where you want to deploy the code, and what is the code version you want to. So I'm just saying rebuilding the last, so that I don't want to write too much. Okay, I'm smart. Okay, so I wanted to do I wanted to have a code job, basically the deployment job, which deploys, and at the end of deployment, it triggers your test job. That's what CI makes it happen, right? So continuous integration means you deploy some code, it in turn starts some tests and reports back, and if it is fine, then it merges to the next pipeline. So similar thing we wanted to try, and we did it. So let me just roughly say that it is 2.6 I am doing. Earlier we had 2.5, right? So I'm saying 2.6 is the build version. I say rebuild. So this is supposed to invoke my other test. So let's go to the mainstream, and you see all the 4 tests are invoked and they are running. This might take a little while because, all right, so we can see the view here actually. Let's refresh. So the moment we invoke that, you see the progress bar, tests are running. Now it becomes the transparency layer. You can actually make yourself feel cool and put it on some dashboard, on some monitor somewhere. Anybody can monitor these tests are running. It means these releases on, okay, so things happen. Okay, So this was intentionally done. I wanted to show you three examples. One is flaky test, second is your intentional test failure or genuine test failure, you can say in this case, and the other one is a passed test. So I invoked, I made flaky test for Firefox, okay? So you can see the tests are running, okay? I'll just minimize your size. Okay, so the tests are running on iOS and Android. You can see the speed difference because of the architecture problems I told you in before. So the tests are running and keep putting the, so there is a 30-second timeout, refresh timeout, you can change it. And it keeps feeding the data in. So my Android test is done. It is passed again. It shows that 2.6 I had run on this machine. And last stable is also the same. In this case, it says that 2.6 is the one. Last it was working on 2.4, not on 2.5 also. Probably, right? So it gives the better clarity to the person who is giving go, no go, or even the DevOps, or even your CTO can look and figure out, okay, these are the release versions, we can either revert back quickly, right? And you can go into detail also. So let's go to the flaky test first, Firefox, right? So I can go to detail reports. So here I have linked all my reports link, very clear reports. It shows that, okay, this directly shows something configuration failed. The test has not run. You can say ignore test. All tests are ignored. You can see the exact errors basically. Clicking on, it shows you exact error. And you know that Firefox has not been launched properly, clearly, right? So it makes, for anybody, you don't need to force anybody to use your tool. You motivate them automatically to look at themselves. So kind of thing. So let's have a look at the other test which we intentionally failed. So there was a Chrome. I had last test probably 7/2. It should turn out to 3.5, but site gives me 3, right? So it's a failure, right? So it gives me right failure reason exactly. I can watch other tests also. These are the passed, neat, clear. Everybody can understand, right? And whatever the failure reason also, they can see, and our logging also. This is useful for us when something goes wrong without your understanding. You have logs in place, you can watch them properly, right? So this is not one thing which is there. There are multiple things which are connected, and everything is open source. So I did not use anything which is proprietary here. Oren will kill me for that. Okay, so this is how I came up with solution. Now, if anybody have any query, if they want to do it similar thing, I'm happy to answer for that before I go to the next slide. Yeah, screenshots, awesome. So I did have a linked screenshot also. You can just go and screenshot. It shows you 3. There was 3. Test was wrong. 3.5 was supposed to come. Right? So if there were multiple failures, it will direct links will take you all the failures screenshots here. So how we did is there is a very awesome plugin image library which we added. So we keep pulling from our existing screenshots path to this path, the job path basically, and linked it in the plugin. How we did is, there is accept plugin, extreme feedback plugin. I'll just take you to probably from slide how we started the journey of this. So this is the actual plugin. Okay, so this was the actual plugin which used to give bare minimal things required for our product was only the feedback, pass or fail. This used to give this screenshot. So when we were trying to get all the information, there was no solution for that. And then I came up with the bare minimum things, which was I want to get the jobs detail, pass or fail at least. So this was to give only this. So we made code around it and added whatever was needed to do a one place solution for it. So which is what you see. This doesn't look very neat. I took help of JavaScript and made it with the relevant informations required. Cool. So this is very important for you to there's one word called sell your bugs. So this is one way to sell your bugs. You have automated, you have put your efforts on, publish them so that they become visible for anyone. How you can do is, it's easy if you open your brain for the open source communities, right? So that is what is in mind. So I'm done with this. You have any query towards for it also, you can write me down also. I would love to help. The last but not least is one point which everybody focuses on, test code to be production quality. How many of you do it? Okay, how do you ensure that it is of production quality? Mm-hmm. Okay. So these are the process exercises. How from the tech exercises? He said that from the review, we should do, just like developers, we should do code review also. We should evolve that culture so that if you find bugs in others' code, it's like makes it more useful for future. But also from the tech perspective also, how while writing itself, before it goes to review. So how do you say that standardization? Okay, cool, nice. You take care of this by following coding standards, wherein I follow another approach, disruptive approach, where sometimes I break those coding standard rules also if they are not fitting into my product needs, my automation needs, or my scalable needs. So if somebody forcibly says that use the design pattern because it is good for their product, I would not do. I would try again, even if it is written in Google metrics, this design pattern versus this design pattern, even if it is written there, I would not directly jump to those conclusions. I would try for my product what is the best pattern would work for us, for now and for the scaling perspective also. That is where we were able to scale our test code from web automation to mobile automation with ease. And that's where we thought of next plan to publish them. All right, so these are the two points. Second point is very interesting, actually. I still see people using it. So I just want to know, how many of you use static methods, static variables very often? No? Oh, damn good. Yes. Yeah. So if you talk about from the grid knowledge and grid world, we get to know that. But even before that, if you know the coding principles properly, you knew it already. So I had seen one, I kind of get sometimes offline requests to check their code. So I got into such problem where I did not see what kind of variable she has defined on top. I just saw the project she was running. It was not giving the exact results what she was supposed to. So, I tried to started debugging, and my mistake, I did not see in the first place what kind of variable she was using. So what her exercise was to invoke test in parallel. So she was not using grid, it was a test ng test. It does the same thing very easily. So she was doing that, and she was, the moment the Firefox launches and Chrome launches, whoever gets the last one takes the control of the first one. Right? So I was like, how come it is happening? And then suddenly I see, oh ho. So she has defined her WebDriver object as a static object. What do you suppose the static, the definition of static is? It means that it is supposed to be shared among all the objects. So no matter how many parallel threads you run, all threads are going to use the same. So whatever is the last state, it will use that. So for the people who, without intention, start using static? I would say no. Say no. I'm not sure about that, but yeah. So whenever you say static, unintentionally you use static, you end up finding it into such troubles for which you do not get the solution. You do not understand why it's happening. So do not do it. Proper logging, proper design pattern, we already talked about. Take screenshots as much as possible, because taking screenshots helped us that pop-up solution which I was talking about, figuring out, yes, it was there, but it was the code was not able to find before click. And then when you automate everything, think about publishing it. All right, that's it. So any, I'm open for questions. Did I do on time? Which we talked about, either publish in the plain fashion. Okay, I'll take you directly there. Either plain fashion over here, any CI tool, or think of advanced level, which this plugin, by the way, you can I have contributed to the repository back, so you can find it either there or on my page also, how to use it. P00J4, you can find it with description, how can you utilize, or where all you can make code changes to help you make it for yourself. So you can fork on my repo and start contributing. Yes, that's, it's not Appium framework, so whatever exercise I did, pardon? So his question is, so the first question or second question? The first question was about the publishing the results. So I went up talking on either you publish in some CI server, or you publish in some more effective way like this, which I talked about. One in short, a quick links to everything. Second question he has is, not question basically, if I have uploaded the framework, a demo framework, a sample framework. So yes, I did have. So whatever test I had shown here running, these tests I have published under my report itself. Actually, you can find GitHub account. You can go and find out. It's there with scalable framework demo under conference 16. So you can find it there. Yeah? P00, I did not write. So it's Pooja, P00J4. All right. Any more queries? Yeah. Can you be?
Coding standard, because if that happened, then the second question might have arise. So don't use a static handler. Okay. So is it like you struggled in terms of finding the static method, right? You face some issues because of they not follow coding standard.
So how much I have understood the question because of the interruption. So your question is either follow the coding standards or when you said disrupt.
No, I noticed some contradict between your conversation. Initially you said like in such condition, you'll be bypassed using the coding standard. Okay, you not follow the coding standard in some.
No,
condition.
I did not say bypass coding standard.
In some condition, right? So and then you say.
I did not say bypass coding standard. I said, okay. Do not jump to any design pattern just because somebody said.
Okay, and next.
You choose at your own product and or own existing resources you available.
And next you say like someone has been mistakenly used a static method, right? So they might have think in this way and they. Never follow the coding standard and they use a static method.
So coding standard and choosing design pattern are two different aspects.
Not only
aspects.
Design pattern, everything to coding standard. Not only design pattern, following design pattern would be not only coding standard. Maintaining the variables in the proper access modifier, everything
yeah, true,
be coding standard.
True. You need to follow coding standards.
Okay.
But you don't have to just follow one particular design pattern just because somebody said. So that is what, I hope I'm making clear, or we can take it offline again. All right. Thank you. So with last line, repeating my CTO's word with you is, whenever you feel that this is not something I can do or this is not something anybody does, always repeat yourself, because nobody is doing, be the one who can. All right, thank you. Thanks for having me here.